God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Welcome to the Hour of Deliverance. I'm Reverend Dr. K.E. Holmes. And, I want to look at Ephesians today, but before I go there, I want to look at the body of Christ. And here I am with my hair distracting me again. Don't let it distract you. I want us to look at Ephesians 4. I hope to stay with the point of us being in the unity of the faith and all and that type of thing. However, I know me that I want to look at everything that's there, and I want to give you every nuance of everything that's there that God has given us. And part of why I want to do that is because just the simplistic of it is like preschool. And it's time for us to have grown up and for us to, I'm going to tuck this so that it won't keep distracting me. Actually, let's go to Proverbs 30. For those of you that don't know, on Facebook, I put up the Proverbs for the day of the month that it is on the calendar that we use. So today is the 30th. Now, that doesn't mean that you're watching it at the 30th. You could be watching it next year, the year after, and if Jesus doesn't come, 100 years after. But the day that I recorded this, it is the 30th of the month. And I'm not even going to say what month, because if you're reading the chapter for the day of the calendar month, you will find that that chapter talks to you, that chapter deals with you and what's going on for your day, and it will direct you. But there's something that is in chapter 30 that I just love to deal with. We're going to go to Ephesians 4. However, I love this, and I also love it for those of you that want to make it that we don't pay the Old Testament any mind anymore, and that Jesus didn't say before the New Testament was written. Jesus said, "Search the Scriptures, and them you think you have eternal life, it's them that speak of me." Now, he said that before there was the new covenant, and he said to search the Scriptures. So for those of us who want to make it like the promises are all gone and all that kind of thing, no, most of what's in the New Testament, the promise of it, is in the Old Testament. And then if you want to get to the Revelation, you have to know the things that God already ordained, taught, and set as his law, as his destination, as his predestination, as his ordination, things that he ordained in the Lamb, his son, slain from the foundation of the earth, things that he ordained. You don't even have a clue of it in Revelation, what he's saying when he talks about being at the door and knock, you know, when he talks about so many things. Let me go to Proverbs so that I can get to Ephesians. Here we go. Proverbs 30, verse 4. Who hath ascended up into heaven or descended? Now, it's a question. Oh, yeah, it's a question. Who hath gathered the wind in his fists? Plural. Who hath bound the waters in a garment? I love God. Who hath established all the ends of the earth? Oh, God, I love you. What is his name? And what is his son's name? If thou canst tell. Now, that's Proverbs 30, verse 4. God answers the question. I always tell you that God is his own best interpreter, and the word of God is its own commentary. And that's coming from me, a person who loves commentaries, reads commentaries just for sport, and loves to just research. some, that's me. It doesn't have to be you. If it is you, then yeah, we're buddies on that. However, I want to, I love this because God asked that in Proverbs. And for those of you that know how old the book is written, or if you think you know and you don't know and all that, you certainly know it's Old Covenant. He asked the question. And in Ephesians 4, oh, I'm in Ephesians 1, and I could really start there to give you all of what is in Ephesians 4. I, therefore, I'm going to start at verse 1. I really want to be in verse 6, but I'm going to start at verse 1. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord. No, don't you let anything keep you bound. Nothing keeps you in prison. Not fear, not anything. See, there I go. I want to go somewhere, and every phrase, I just have to give some of what God has given. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you, okay? Now, he's not just talking about me. The word's talking to me, but it's talking to you. And that's something that we who love the Lord, we need to always remember. Because when we assess a thing, we usually think it applies to they and them. And it applies, the word's talking to me. So he says here, I beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherein ye are called. Now, some of us don't even know that it is a vocation. We know something about vocation because of the day and times that we live in. And some of us don't realize that Jesus said, occupy till I come. Now, if you're a warrior and that type of thing, you're thinking that he said, occupy the land. It's not that he didn't, but when somebody else who wants to deal in times when jobs are difficult or something like that, then we think he's talking about occupation. Well, it doesn't mean that he isn't. I'm letting you know that he is. Usually when God leaves it open, he's talking about all of that and more that we don't know to think about. Well, I'm letting you know to go ahead and think about it, because Jesus said, occupy till I come. That means take control. You be the one in charge. It also means let this be your occupation. Okay? And I thought I wanted to read it out in my Bible, but I'm going to go read it from here so you won't keep looking at the top of my head. I can hold this up and read it from here. And he says, there we go. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy. Now it says ye. I'm using King James, and I always tell you one of the reasons why I like King James, and I'm not going to go through that because I want to get through this chapter. Walk worthy of the vocation wherein ye are called. Oh, I so want to deal with those phrases. Now he says, do this with all lowliness. Now he could have stopped right there, and if he did stop right there, it would take us the rest of our lives to just do it, do that like that, as a prisoner of the Lord, to walk worthy of the vocation, and that we're called, not that you're called, not that you're called, not that you're called, but that you're called, that you're called. Hmm? Not that I'm called, that you're called. Walk, he says, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. Now, he ended with in love, but I'm letting you know that you need to start in love just to do the lowliness part. It takes it when you know who you are in Christ, when you know what you're called to, there's a whole lot that you need to step up to. But it has to be with lowliness so that you can be the great that you are in him, and not cow down to it, not live up to it. And we seem to make it as if it can only be one way or the other. You can't be great and humble at the same time. First of all, humble means teachable. You're not apologizing for existing, and you're not apologizing for being wonderful. You're not apologizing for being great. Does Jesus apologize for being good? Does he apologize for being wonderful? No, he is. And we want to be like him, except for some of that stuff, we act like we don't. Now, let's get through this Ephesians here. Lord God, help me. Father God, in the name of Jesus, help me. With all lowliness and meekness, I already told you, meekness has to do with being teachable. It doesn't mean that you're always hiding in the back and standing in the back and in the background. Maybe you are. Maybe that's your personality. And I do want to let you know that this business of being an introvert, psychology has its things, but come on. We follow the word, not psychology. It doesn't mean you can't know things, but what you follow, you know, with all meekness and long-suffering, you know, what you walk worthy of means that you're going to know what's going on, but it doesn't mean you have to buy into it. And part of why I say that is because when I was a teenager, psychology said some things about different things, and before I got to half the age that I am now, psychology was saying the complete opposite. Psychology was saying something quite different. Now, if I mention it, I'm going to make some people mad, so I'm not even going there. I'm just letting you know that there were some things that psychology said was a sickness. And some of you know that, say, about alcoholism. Maybe I can choose that one. It won't make some people mad. That once psychology and psychiatry taught us that addictions are a sickness, it was to have the effect of making us more tolerant. You know, what he says here about lowliness and meekness with long suffering. Forbearing one another in love. Listen, you don't need psychology to tell you that something is a sickness for you to treat somebody with lowliness, meekness, long-suffering, and forbearing them. Okay? We waited too late if psychology has to name the beggar on the street or on the highway, wherever the beggar is, if psychology has to tell us that it's not their fault. I mean, that's a popular thing today. Everything, it's not your fault. Well, what if it is? Does Jesus leave you in a lurch because it is your fault? I was talking to somebody just the other day about some of the things that Hezekiah, being a righteous king, being wonderful, but he did some things and they were his fault. And God still had mercy. I really want you to know that he's telling us here, as a prisoner of the Lord, Jesus is Lord, I beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherein ye are called, not according to what is going on in society, and do know what's going on in society, but you do it because that's what the word has you do. You do it because that thing that I read in Proverbs 1, because, pardon me, Proverbs 30, did I lose it? The one who ascended and who also descended, you know, because of what he gave, we're gonna see it in this chapter, the answer to that. Let me read it again, because I already took so long to get to where I'm trying to go to. Proverbs 30, verse 4. Who hath ascended up into heaven, or descended? Who hath gathered the wind in his fists? Who hath bound the waters in a garment? Who hath established all the ends of the earth? What is his name? And what is his son's name, if thou canst tell? Oh, God, I love you. God, I love you. Maybe I ought to speed read, using an expression, to get down to where I want to show you where he answers that question. But for the vocation that you're called, with all lowliness and meekness and with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love, I'll come back to it. Let me get up to this other verse. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Peace isn't a matter of, I won't argue with you. I'm not going to argue with you because I want to move in love. I'm not going to argue with you because God wants us to as much as lies within us in one scripture, he says, walk peaceably with all men. Because he says that these six things doth the Lord hate, and yea, the seventh is an abomination. And that seventh one is he that sows discord among the brethren. That's why I'm not going to argue with you, because that's not what God wants. What we're going to do is do word. We're going to let the peace of God rule in our hearts. We're going to let the word of Christ dwell in us richly. That's Colossians, okay? And look it up in case it's Philippians. Anyway, he says, and back to Ephesians, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. You see, peace is a bond. It's a bond, it's a chain link bond, like an iron link, but it's a bond the way that husband and wife are bound to one another. Now, we make a vow, but Jesus already made the vow. That's what you're going to see about he that, I got to read it in Proverbs because I think God flips it in Ephesians. But he ascended up into heaven, and the Proverbs says, or descended. And we're going to see here in Ephesians that he descended. When he died, oh, he descended, and then he ascended. And I want you to walk in the victory that's there, that he ascended. But some of that victory means that we walk in long-suffering with one another. We walk in the bond of the Spirit. Pardon me, let me say it how he said it. We walk in the unity of the Spirit, in the bond of peace. So that if you're not unified with me on what I think about the word, then there's no peace? No. We got to do this like the word says. Walk worthy of the vocation, okay? Occupy till I come, Jesus said. So, there is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called. There he goes about that calling again. There he goes about that calling, about walk worthy of the vocation wherein ye are called. Okay, there is one body, one Spirit, even as you are called, in one hope of your calling. Do we even know what that is? I mean, most of us can't even say it off the top of our head, though we do know, we probably know. But what is the hope of your calling? Now, some will say to get to heaven, some will say to escape hell. One God, and yet he asks the question, remember Proverbs 30? And you got to know he's talking about God when he starts asking, who hath gathered the wind in his fists and hath bound the waters in a garment and hath established the ends of the earth? But then he turns around and he asks, what is his name? And what is his son's name? I mean, I have a son and he's named after his father, but they're two different people and neither one of them are God. I'm not trying to say they're God, but I'm showing you that. You clearly know he's talking about God, and God's giving us a revelation in even what he's asking over there in Proverbs 30, verse 4, but he's answering it here in Ephesians, and he's giving us some information about what all that means, where all that takes us, where we want to think, so that if you're thinking over on, I'm in a town, Catasauqua Road is nearby. Yeah, that's an Indian name. If you don't even know what Catasauqua means, still, Catasauqua Road is nearby. If you're over there on Catasauqua Road and God wants you to be on Route 78, it doesn't make Catasauqua Road wrong. It just makes that you're on a different road. And what God is doing here, what he's doing here in this, is he's setting us aright. He's making all things. He's giving the parallel. He's giving the relation. He's giving the scope. So that when he answers this question, if you already have a doctrine. Like when I went to Bible college, oh my goodness, there were so many doctrines on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I would think there was only one resurrection. I would think there'd only be one doctrine. Well, that was stupid of me. One God and Father of all. Now, if I'm going to argue with you and if I'm going to divide from you, what does that do to Father? He's still Father of all. So what does that do to you and I? Are you not my brother? Am I not your sister? Oh. One God and Father of all. And then that's not what he said. He said, who is above all and through all. If I said something you don't like and it's not God the Father through, if you said something I don't like, it's not something through. Just today I'm listening to a song and someone made it their prayer. And there's two things in the song that I can't pray that. I'm not saying I never did, but God corrected me from that. Does that mean that that's your correction? God gave it through me about that thing. Does that mean he couldn't have given the sister who made it her, and I think it was called real prayer? No, I always remind you that in the seven churches, he who has an ear, each one of the churches, seven different churches, he said, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches, not just what he said to you. Okay, so, verse 7, Ephesians 4, 7. But unto every one of us is given grace, according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Now I have to go there, Okay. The word gift there is not charismata. It is not, he's not talking about gifts of the Spirit at all. Not anywhere in this chapter. He's going to name some things that you're used to it being a part of the list of the gifts of the Spirit, which it doesn't even belong in the way that so many people have taught it. However, if that's how you learned it, then that's what you think. And we just want to stay with the scripture here. So I'm letting you know ahead of time that none of this is that word charismata or charisma or any of those things that have to do with the gifts of the Spirit. Most of the time, I want to go to the Greek. But it's not. It's the word that we hear, dorion, but the measure of the gift of Christ. Now, most of us know about the fullness of the gift of Christ, and we want to walk in that. Here, he's talking about you walking worthy of the vocation that you're called. And you want to do that, every one of us. Now, that's each one. Each one is given grace. You're given the ability beyond what you think is your ability. Father was dealing with me with that this morning. I was looking at something and dealing with something, and I'm like, well, that's not my expertise. That's not my thing. And God let me know it's his, and he's in me. So, according to the grace that he's given. So, according to every one of us is given grace, you have the ability. You have the equipment also, but grace, you've got the ability. According to the measure of the gift of Christ. And again, this is not the charismatic gift, okay? Now, he says, wherein he says, or because of this, he says, now watch this, this is the answer to the question. When he ascended up on high, remember that Proverbs? Who ascended up into heaven? Or descended? Ephesians 4:8. Wherein he saith, he said it, he's saying it, and he's going to keep on saying it. When he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive, and he gave gifts unto men. Here again, that word is not charisma. It has nothing to do with the gifts of the Spirit. I so want to stop and explain all that. I have a course called Gifts Administrations Operations on 1 Corinthians 12. He gave gifts unto men. Now watch, that is in relation to the fact that he ascended up on high and that he led captivity captive. Now, he's going to tell us what that means, but basically, those who were captive, he set you free, except for that he didn't set you free to just go anywhere, do anything. It's not like when you open a bird cage and everything, they all fly everywhere. No. He took you somewhere and gave gifts unto men. Now watch this. He gave gifts. Now that's human. He gave gifts. Now this is not gifts of the Spirit. This is a whole different word than the word gifts over there where he talks about gifts of the Spirit. Now that he ascended, he's still talking about answering that he's asked over there in Proverbs 30, verse 4. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first? The first thing he did was descend. I love that about God. You know, he was looking at, he's always looking after us. Part of why you want to count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations is because you know that God had that thing worked out with the lamb slain from the foundation of the earth. Though that you're dealing with it in your right now, you want to just know all the promises in him are yes and all the promises in him are amen. And no matter what you're facing, you know, we like to quote that scripture that God won't put more on you than what you can bear. And we usually stop right there. The next part of that phrase, the next part of that verse, the very next phrase says that, or he'll give you a way of escape. Most of us are looking, we're worried about what we can bear, what we can take, instead of looking for the way of escape so that that thing doesn't take us. Most of the stuff that we deal with is bigger than us. Remember the disciples in the ship, and the scripture says there was a great storm and they're scared. They were professionals. They were professional fishermen. They weren't scared at a little rocking of a boat. The word of God says it was a great storm. Jesus said, don't be afraid. You need to understand when Jesus tells you don't be afraid, everywhere he says in his word, don't be afraid. It's something that could kill us. He's not telling us don't be afraid of nothing. He's letting us know. Yeah, without me, that thing could kill you. So after the scripture lets you know it was a great storm, and if you're thinking according to occupation, they were professional fishermen. They knew a great storm. They knew when it was a storm that's just rocking the boat and water's getting in the boat and a storm that could capsize everybody and kill everything. Scripture says it was a great storm. Jesus told them, don't be afraid. And then he said, now I do remember offhand the Greek in it is be muzzled, but he said, peace, be still. And the scripture says it was a great calm. You see, when you fall into diverse temptations, I mean, stuff that really could hurt you, really could kill you, really could take you out, don't just know that he won't put more on you than you can bear. Most of our temptations are more than what most of us can bear. Just from the fact of how we want to argue and put ourselves in the position of being an abomination to God. That's more than we can bear. Most of us need to realize that he gave us a way of escape. And not just use it as a saying that it's Jesus Christ. Look for how he gave you to escape. Jesus spoke to the storm. And he said, be muzzled. He didn't go get a bucket and start throwing water out the boat. He spoke to the storm. What's the way of escape that he's given you? So that you're laughing, so that you're joyful, so that you can count it all joy. And even with that, I want to give a shout out to, love you, Nicole, but I'm shouting out to your prophet boys. Because, yeah, they're toddlers. We think of them as just babies, just children. They are major, major, major prophets. Samuel and Benjamin, major prophets. Don't wait for them to grow up and figure out the vocation wherein they are called. They're major prophets right now. They'll speak to a storm that you're busy trying to get the bucket, throwing the water out the boat with your grown self, you know. And I'm saying that for me too. Recognize your babies came here, major prophets, and they'll come with the word, be still. They'll come with the word, be muzzled, as young as they are, because they are major, major, major prophets. Samuel and Benjamin, I love you so much. I love you so much. Okay, so the vocation wherein you're called. Now, he that ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended, answering that Proverbs 30, verse 4 question. Far above all heavens, I'd love to stop and tell you the testimony about that, that he might fill all things. See, when you think you're not good enough and you can't fill these boots and you can't walk in this, well, guess what? He already did. He already did. He already did. So you got this. You got this. And he gave some. Now remember, I already told you, this is not gifts of the Spirit. These are dorian gifts that he gave, not charismata gifts. And he gave gifts unto men, it says, okay? Okay? This isn't you died and went to heaven and sprouted wings gifts. Some apostles, not everybody. Not everybody, some apostles, and some prophets. And I really want to look up that word again. I have it in the course. And some evangelists, and some pastor, and that and is actually a hyphen, pastor teachers. So we have, I know we like to say fivefold ministry, but it's apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastor teachers. And in 1 Corinthians, he says 1st, 2nd, 3rd. He says apostles, prophets, teachers. 1 Corinthians 12. And that's where God names 1st, 2nd, 3rd. Here he's giving. He's not giving a number. I'm showing you that he's talking about something similar but different. Now look, he says why this is. For the perfecting of the saints. He's not telling you how. He tells us how in just a minute. Right here he's telling us the why. For the perfecting of the saints. So if you pull away from me and I pull away from you on these that God gave, then I'm making it so that we can't be perfected. Am I really doing that? That's like I'm on Catasauqua Road when he wanted me to be on whatever road I had said, you know, 78. God saying be on 78. And you're over there on Catasauqua Road. Catasauqua Road is for something else. This one, it's for the perfecting of the saints. Mm-hmm. And the cross streets, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastor teachers, you know, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry. See, if you don't want to work in the ministry like I think you ought to work in the ministry, if you don't want to do what I think I'm called to do, if you don't want to do what I think you're called to do, then I think that you're not doing the ministry, much less work. And I'm saying some of the things that we, the body of Christ, some of the things that we say when people don't do things just the way that we think, when we don't lead people to Christ by way of the Roman road, when we don't lead people to Christ by way of the Gospels. Oh my. Oh my. Oh, I felt that get to your heart. I mean, I really did. I felt that get to your heart. oh, error. What is she teaching? Error, error. I already reminded you that Jesus said, search the scriptures before the gospels were written, while he's living the living gospel. Search the scriptures. In them, you think you have eternal life? It's them that speak of me. Part of what God used to get me into ministry, because I just didn't want to. I wanted to lead everybody to Jesus that I met, but I didn't want these, I called them titles, because I saw how we are with one another about it. So I didn't want that. I didn't want that kind of a scrutiny and attention. And part of what he did with me is that I just wanted everybody to be saved. I wanted everybody to know that Jesus loves you and he'll forgive you. You're a mess, and you know that you're a mess, and he'll still forgive you, and he'll still change you, he'll still cleanse you. And when you don't know what to do, and when you do know what to do, he'll give you a what to do that is so beyond anything and so much more wonderful. I wasn't trying to be a minister. I wasn't trying to minister anything. I just wanted people to know before they died. And I had an understanding that the error of our sin and the mess that we walk in will cause us to die prematurely. And I was still a teenager, and I understood you can die right now. And I didn't live in a neighborhood where there was crime going on all over everywhere. It wasn't like that. It was that I understood the depravity of sin. Didn't know that word depravity at the time, but I understood that you can be so wrong in yourself that the only right and righteous thing is that you die. I understood being worthy of death even before I actually did anything that the law would consider. When I mean the law, I mean the law where I lived at that time was Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Anything that the law in the United States of America, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, would say that I deserve death. I understood in my soul that I'd gone there. And it would only be right if I died. Thankfully, somebody shared with me the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father and his Son, and told me his name is Jesus. And so I wasn't trying to enter ministry or anything. I just wanted everybody to know. Everybody. And I wanted them to know right away before they even got to the place where, yeah, you had to actually be killed. So, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and please understand, the ministry is work. Doesn't mean it has to work you out and wear you out, but the ministry is work. It's not just pray, roll over, go to sleep, roll back over, and wake up with a revelation and go to sleep. And God will do that. Please understand, God will do that. When you have worked and worked and worked and represented him, yes, he will put you to sleep. And then he'll wake you up with revelation and put you back to sleep. And especially if you're male, God talks to men in their sleep so much, all through the word. But understand that it's for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying, the building up of the body of Christ. Yes, it builds you up. You're part of the body of Christ. And if you're as naive as I was, I always thought when God revealed something to me and built me up, I was so, even this morning, God had me actually laughing about something. And I thought it was, you know, for me. And then I got a phone call. And it was some serious stuff on the other side of the earth. And God, I mean, it was serious. And the person called me because it was serious. And they're on this side of the planet. And together, we went to where God had shown me. And it was to laugh, not to be frightened by the storm, not to be frightened by what the enemy perpetrated. It was to go into the open triumph, the victory, that he that descended is also he that ascended and gave gifts unto men. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. But watch this. I'm digressing there on the testimony of what just happened a few hours ago. Till we all come into the unity of the faith. That's how long. It's not looking at how hard and how heavy or how weighty the trial or the test or the complications. Till we all come into the unity of the faith. I don't stop praying for you or rooting for you because you think something that I don't think or even believe something that I know fully well is not the truth. If you anyway, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the building up, the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come into the unity of the faith. The faith unifies us. When you look at the faith chapter, I always remind you that there's a bunch of stuff that went on when you read it in the Old Covenant, when you read it, especially Genesis, when you read some of that stuff, you know that there was more to that story, but what counts in the faith chapter is what counts. What God upholds through faith, by faith, that faith chapter starts out that through faith we understand. We don't understand through thinking. We don't understand all the way through doctrine. Some things we need to understand before God gives us gives us doctrine. I'm referring to Isaiah 28:10, where he says, "Who will I give knowledge? Who will I teach doctrine? The one who's weaned from the breast." Talking about Benjamin, little prophet Benjamin, and little prophet Samuel, they were prophets when they were still on the breast. They were prophets. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of God. Pardon me, let me say what it says here. And the knowledge of the Son of God. The Son of God. You see, there's so much that God has ordained in his Son that we need to be up on that. You know, we like to so much go to Jesus Christ crucified. That's the Son of God. Yes, it is. He ordained some things in his Son that we need to understand from that perspective. Even, you know what? Remember the Mount of Transfiguration? Moses is there. Elijah's there. Jesus is there. And the disciples, I mean, the precious, precious, precious ones, the called ones, they really are the called ones. They really are the anointed ones. They really are the appointed ones. Even they said, let's make a monument, da 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 da. And God had to say, God the Father had to say, from heaven, "This is my Son. Hear him." It doesn't mean that Moses isn't who he was and Elijah didn't do what he did. They're wonderful, and that God would have us to know. But my Son, hear him. Hear him. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. I'm always reminding you, when you look at Revelation 1, there's a description of Jesus Christ. And as a matter of fact, in Revelation chapter 1, it tells you that it is the revelation of Jesus Christ. Do I want to go there? Yeah, I'm going to go away from the Proverbs scripture to go there, to take you to what he tells us in Revelation. We need to stop making it hard, because the way of the transgressor is hard, the scripture tells us. But the book of Revelation starts out, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. Kind of like if you're busy looking on Catasauqua Road and he wants you looking at 78. Yeah, there's a whole lot of things. There's 57 sevens in the book of Revelation. And do you want to study the sevens? It doesn't mean that you don't. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Because he gives a whole revelation here, and then he speaks to each of the churches out of a piece of that, out of some of that. And that wasn't the rebuking part of it, by the way. He wasn't saying, you need to know me more fully. I want to go back to the, I'll stay in Revelation over there. So, Ephesians 4:12, for the perfecting of the saints, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastor teachers, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. And how long? Till they get on your nerves? I've heard so many pastors say about people that want to leave the church, you know, don't let the door hit you, you know. No, that's not what he said. That's not what God said. First of all, pastors in Ezekiel 33:34, you're supposed to look after the sheep. The sheep go do some stuff. And then they lead other sheep to do some stuff. You're supposed to look after them. And God rebukes the shepherd that doesn't. God rebukes the shepherd. He also rewards the shepherd that looks after the sheep the way he said. You know the vocation where you're called? You know? So he says, how long? Till you're sick of them? Moses got in trouble for that. Moses, he didn't get to enter into the promised land because he let the sheep get on his nerves and have him do something different than the way God said. We need to stop, we leaders, we need to stop making it that, or the body of Christ, that the person who sins, they sin so bad that they're a cast out. Listen. Manasseh was the worst king ever, and God said so. Not just the people said so. That's what God had to say. And yet, when he repented, God forgave him. You hear this? You hear this? Okay. So how long? Till we all come into the unity of the faith. Well, that, for me, that means that's till Jesus comes, because the more I look, the more division I see. And I keep asking God, give me to see how you see and look through your vision and through your eyes, because what I see, till we all come into the unity of the faith, and watch this, and of the knowledge of the Son of God. That's the knowledge we want to come into. Right now, as a matter of fact, we've always been so concerned with political correctness. I first started paying attention to this with Eisenhower dealing with the USSR and all that kind of stuff, President Eisenhower. And I used to overhear government talk because my mother worked for the government. Till we come to the unity of the faith, okay? And the knowledge of the Son of God. There are so many things that we come into the knowledge of. You don't reject the knowledge because it is contrary to the knowledge of the Son of God. Part of why some of us need to know of the things that are contrary to the knowledge of the Son of God is so that when he shows us the way of escape, we're not still on that road over there, and we can get on this route over here, that God would have us be the pillar, be the one who changes the mind of society, be the one who takes on the businesses, or the media. We would be the ones who set the mind. Right now, so much of the body of Christ needs a mindset, a mind change, including me. So much God has been letting me know of when I don't like it. I just want to be done with it. That's not Jesus. What he came to his own. And his own refused him, received him not, Did he go away? No, he stayed. He came. Did he not die? Pardon me, he died. He descended and he ascended. Did he say we're too far gone? No, he gave gifts unto men. He gave authority, place, and position. I always remind you, in the beginning, Elohim, in the beginning, shows us time, order, place, position, and purpose. And Jesus, we have that in him. And it is until we all come into the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. And watch this, he's not finished. He's not finished. He says, unto a perfect man. Every denomination likes to talk about how nobody's perfect, nobody's perfect, nobody's perfect. Well, does that mean then that you can't ever fulfill what God said to fulfill here? Unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Now, he talked about the grace of the measure of Christ. So it's in Christ, by Christ, and through Christ that this is done. And he lets us know where to do it. Unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Most of us are still trying to do the pinky of Christ, just a little bit. And he says, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. I actually want to skip down because time is going. I'm going to read it fast. That we henceforth be no more children. Remember Isaiah 28:10, who am I going to show knowledge and teach doctrine? The one who's weaned from the breast, okay? No more children tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine. Every wind. Oh, what's going through the body of Christ now? What's going through the politics now? No, 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 no. We're not carried about by winds of doctrine or by the sleight of men. Not even the serpent being more subtle. Men being subtle and cunning and crafty, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. No deception, but speaking the truth in love. Speaking the truth in love. Not just speaking the truth because it's the truth. Not that I'm just saying. You say in love. Because when you say in love, God is love, God is life. When you say in love, it ministers life. It ministers life. But speaking the truth in love, that may grow up into him in all things, not just the things I like, not just the things like the seven churches were different things, not just the things that they're called to, but all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies. You see, just because my doesn't look like my hand is using the blood, because you can't see blood coming out my hand, the blood flows through all parts. All parts. We're compacted together. Just because my arm is connected to my shoulder doesn't mean that my foot doesn't have anything to do with it. It's fitly compacted in the right place and in the right way. And he says, by that which every joint supplies, every joint has purpose. Not just the ones we like, not just the ones we agree with. Working in the measure of every part, making increase of the body, unto the edifying of itself. We have to grow in love. God is love. God is life. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth, from here on, walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind, having their understanding darkened. You're light. You don't go by darkening of understanding. Being alienated from the life of God through ignorance. If somebody's ignorant, you bring them into the unity of the faith. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. It says here, because of blindness of the heart, who being past feeling, giving themselves over to lasciviousness, to work all uncleanness with greediness. Mm-hmm. But you, you have not so learned Christ. That's not what you learned of him. If you have been, if so be that you heard him, he that ascended, who also descended. You've been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus. Put off the old man. Stop fussing and arguing. Put on the new man. Just like I put this on, put it on. Put it on. He gave you the garment. He that ascended also descended. He gave you what you need to walk in love. Oh, he gave it. It was expensive and he gave it. Don't give place to the devil. Don't let corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Walk in the love that he gave. Be the body. Don't go cutting something off because you don't like it. When you wake up, if your foot didn't agree with you, you shook it and you did till it agreed and acted like part of the body. Walk in the vocation wherein ye are called. Father God, I thank you so much for my brethren, for my sisters. I thank you for the body that you've made us. I thank you that you even call it body so that we can look at the body we live in to know how we move in you, one body, not hurting ourselves because of something we don't like, but we move in health, wholeness, and healing. We move in the newness of Christ. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. So I finished up slightly early, but I want you to know that Proverbs, oh, well, I went to Revelation now, but that Proverbs 30, verse 4, I'm sorry, I'm looking, I'm so used to the Hebrew canon order. That Proverbs 30, verse 4. Should have read it just to see if that was the closing. Who hath ascended up into heaven or descended? Who hath gathered the wind in his fist? Who hath bound up the waters in a garment? Who hath established all the ends of the earth? What is his name? What is his son's name? If thou canst tell. And he told us over in Ephesians 4. And he told us what we're to do with that. Jesus Christ the righteous. Amen. Since it looks like I'm still on the air, I was going to turn to the IMs that I have for you. You're blessed and anointed of God. You are ablaze with the glory of God. God has blessed the work of your hands, and you walk in favor with God and man. chosen generation, a royal priesthood.